All right, let's go ahead and go over our unique starter pets. These are pets that you can only get if you are a specific race. These pets are going to be 100% unique and unobtainable unless you are playing that race. First up, we have the Slate Direhorn. And you guessed it, these pets belong to the Zandalari Trolls. Now, there are other Direhorns in the game, but none with this runic stone aesthetic to them. And normally you can't even train a Direhorn unless you have an ancient tome of Dinomancy, but the Zandalari Trolls are going to come stock with this bad boy right here. Next up, we'll look at the starter pet for the Cole Tyran humans, and it's going to be the Peregrine Falcon. This gray, black, and brown spotted pattern is only obtainable as a Cole Tyran human starter pet. Belonging to the Dark Iron Dwarves is going to be the Blaze Hound. This is one of my favorite models, and it has such a unique fiery appearance to it that is not present in the game anywhere else. The Blazehound does belong to the dog family, and if you're looking to have one of these bad boys as a pet, be sure to start unlocking your Dark Iron Dwarves. Next up, we'll be taking a look at the Mechanical Bunny, and if you had one guess what race this belongs to, I mean, come on, it's pretty obviously the gnomes. Now, both gnomes and goblins can tame any mechanical pet. If you are not one of these two races, you're going to need something called a Mechabond Imprint Matrix, which I will go over later in the video. If you start a Nightborn Hunter, you're going to have a Mana Saber by your side. While it may look like a Spirit Beast, the starting pet for the Nightborns, the Mana Saber, is actually part of the Cat family. You can tame Spirit Beasts that look just like this guy, but the Mana Saber is going to be the only Cat family pet with this coloring. Now, my favorite pet that you cannot get anywhere else besides starting an allied race is going to belong to the Void Elves, and it's going to be called the Void Stalker. So look at that thing. Void Stalkers, they are fairly common in the game, but the Void Elf starter Void Stalker has a specific purple coloring to it that cannot be attained by any other means. Alright guys, that's going to be it for the unique starter pets. Let's move on to the skill tames section. Now, as a hunter, there are certain pets that you're not going to be able to tame right off the bat. Skill tames are tames that require players to acquire a specific item or skill before they're able to tame a certain family of creatures. The first skill tame that we're going to be going over is the Blood Beasts. Now, you can find these guys wandering around Nazmir and Zul'Dazar, and in order to tame these guys, you'll need a blood-soaked tome of Dark Whispers. Now, you can get this tome from Normal, Heroic, or Mythic Zul in Uldir. Belonging to the Blood Beast is going to be the Krog model and the Blood Tick model. Now, we have multiple colors for each, and I personally don't really like these models, but if you're into some bloody, infected, creepy, monster-looking type pets, these are going to be the guys for you. Blood Beasts belong to the Tenacity family, giving us a little bit more survivability, and they come with the unique ability Blood Bolt. Says the Blood Beast belches blood at the target, reducing movement speed for 50% for 6 seconds. Kind of gross, but at the same time, a 50% 6 second slow is not bad. All right, now let's take a look at the Feather Manes. Now you can see these guys walking around, or flying around rather, all over Azeroth. Now there's going to be 5 different models of Feather Manes. Going to be the Griffin, the Hippogriff, the Owlcat, the Wolfhawk, and the Weavern, otherwise known as the Windrider. These all come in a variety of colors, and this has got to be one of my top 3 favorite pet families, especially the Wolfhawk there. Introduced in Legion, you need the Tome of the Hybrid Beast in order to tame one of these guys. But the Tome of the Hybrid Beast was originally tied to your artifact weapon progress, but now you just need to complete a set of achievements. So it's going to be 3 achievements to be able to unlock this tome. The first one being a Glorious Campaign, the second one called Breaching the Tomb, and the third is going to be Knight of the Wilds. And I believe that completing that third achievement, the Knight of the Wilds, will actually earn you the mount version of the Wolfhawk. After you complete these achievements, you can purchase the Tome of the Hybrid Beast from Pan the Kind Hand, an NPC in Trueshot Lodge, for 1,000 order resources. Feather Manes are also going to belong to the Tenacity specialization, giving us Survival of the Fittest and the Endurance Training skills. They also come with a special ability called Feather Flurry. Says the Feather Mane flaps wildly, flinging feathers into the air that distracts its enemies, increasing dodge chance by 30% for 20 seconds. So 20% buff to your dodge and 30%, that is not bad, especially in a PvP situation, or even an endgame PvE content. Feather Manes also come with the ability Updraft, which is going to let you jump off, straight up jump off a cliff and slowly fall down to the ground. Great for battlegrounds. Great if you get dismounted in world PvP. And all in all, just a cool ability. Next up, we're going to be looking at the Direhorns. These guys will be roaming around the Isle of Giants, Isle of Thunder, and in Zul'Dazar. And they come in both a armored and non-armored model. The armored blue Direhorn is actually going to be a raid boss in the Throne of Thunder called Horadon. This raid belongs to the Mists of Pandaria expansion, so if you want to just go ahead and go in there solo and try to tame this bad boy up, I don't think anybody would stop you. In order to tame the Direhorn, you're going to need the Ancient Tome of Dinomancy, which is going to be a rare drop from the Zandalari Dinomancers located on the Isle of Giants. Yet another Tenacity pet bringing us some good old-fashioned survivability, Direhorns also come with the ability Gore. Says the Direhorn drives its horns into the target, causing the mortal wounds effect, grievously wounding the target and reducing the effectiveness of any healing received for 10 seconds. This is a go-to pet ability for PvP content. Arenas, battlegrounds, raided battlegrounds, whatever you want to do. Alright, next up, let's take a look at our mechanical pets. The mechanical pet family was first introduced in Legion, and as I said previously, gnomes and goblins are both able to tame mechanicals without a special item. Now, if you're not a goblin and you're not a gnome, then you're going to need something called the Mechabond Imprint Matrix. This is an item crafted by engineers. So if you're an engineer, you can go ahead and craft one yourself. If not, be sure to go over and check out the auction house. Now, at the time of this recording, the Mechabond Imprint Matrix is going for around 30k gold on the auction house, which is a little bit spendy, but if you're interested in these mechanical pets, and I mean, there are a lot. I mean, we have electric sheep, iron scorpions, mech parrots, robotic gorillas, mech spiders, mech squirrels, mech tigers, mechano striders, mechano wolves, and even robot chickens. So for a lot of players, dropping 30k to tame all these different models is going to be a reasonable purchase. Mechanical pets are going to belong to the Cunning family, bringing along some good mobility skills, including Master's Call and Pathfinding, and they also bring the special ability Defense Matrix. The mechanical contraption creates a personal defense matrix around itself, reducing damage taken by 50% for 12 seconds, a very strong defensive cooldown on a 1-minute cooldown. And that's going to be it for our skill tames. Remember, a skill tame is going to be a pet that you can't tame without a specific item or ability. Now, we're going to be moving on to the challenging tames. And challenging tames is basically any tame that's going to require more than just walking up and taming them. These pets are often the most difficult to obtain, so you're not going to see a lot of hunters using them. A lot of these pets are also very highly sought after, so if you're camping out a spawn location for them, be prepared to have some competition. Suffice it to say, for most of these upcoming tames, you are going to need to want it. According to WoWhead, challenging tames are any pet that requires you to camp spawn points, perform special quests, or use certain abilities in a specific way before you're able to tame them. These are the pets that I consider a piece of endgame if you are a hunter player. Probably the most well-known challenge tame and also favorite among the community is going to be Hati. Now, when Legion came out, Beastmastery Hunters got to wield Titan Strike, which gave us Hati for the entire expansion. Now, after patch 8.1.5, Hati returns as a tameable pet, and it's going to involve basically a very, very long quest line. The quest line is going to start with a quest called Spark of Genius, and goes and goes and goes and goes until you reach a quest called Bonds of Thunder. Afterwards, Hati will become tameable. And if you keep moving forward in this quest line, in the quest Reverberation, you will be able to unlock 5 new appearances for Hati. There's a black version, brown, dark blue, dark gray, light gray, and a silver blue variation. A lot of hunters have this pet, whether they use it or not, so it's almost like if you don't have it, do you even hunter? You know? Hati, unlike other challenge tames, also comes with a variety of toys, some of which are pretty cool, like the Iron Spine Protocol, which says it enhances Hati's size and constitution, allowing mounting. So you can actually mount your pet. I actually didn't know that. That's cool. Here's another one called Charged Sparkstone. Says bring out the latent power in Hati's lighting, visually enhancing Hati's abilities. Nothing too OP about that, just a visual rework to the, just a visual enhancement to the ability effects. Hati is actually the first pet with a static name, so you can't even change the name unless you have an item called the Certificate of Ownership. Just something to note if you want to go after this guy. Next up, let's take a look at the Sabertronge located in Storm Song Valley. Now, you can see the red Sabertrons walking all around. They're not too much of a hassle to tame, but if you want to get any of the other colors, and it does come in a copper, gold, green, orange, and red, you're going to need to wait for the Sabertron World Quest to activate. Now, there's an indicator on the world map to show you where this quest is actually going to pop up. But basically, once you walk inside this cave, there's going to be a Sabertron of each color, but they're going to be inactive. In order to activate one and make it tameable, you have to kill the Sabertron Technician inside the cave. Basically, once you kill the Sabertron Technician, he's going to activate one of these Sabertrons, and they're going to go attack you, and that's when it becomes tameable. Now, you can go into this cave and kill the Sabertron Technician when the World Quest isn't active, but if you do that, he's just going to send another red one at you. If you want to get one of the other colors, you have to wait until the World Quest is up and then go into the cave, at which point he will activate one random color Sabertron. That's going to be the same color for the entire day. So if you want one of the gold or the green ones, make sure to check out this little cave here in Stormsong Valley. Now, this is my absolute favorite model in this entire video. It's going to be the Panthara. We've got these in a variety of colors. We have a blue-gray, fell green, pink, and a violet model. Now, in order to tame these guys, you're going to need an item called the Fresh Talbuk Meat. You can get this item by just going around and killing mobs of the Chitinous Crag Scaler. However, it's a very, very rare drop, but fortunately, you can find the Fresh Talbuk Meat on the auction house. So here's the thing with this one. You'd think that you'd be able to just walk up and feed the meat to the Panthara and it becomes tameable, but the catch is that you can only feed them the meat when you're out of combat, and walking into range puts you into combat. So, here's the secret. So what you're going to want to do after you have the Fresh Talbuk Meat is walk around and find the Panthara that you like. When you get close, you're going to want to toss a Freezing Trap on it, walk next to the Panthara, and then feign death to drop your aggro. Once you've dropped your aggro, go ahead and open up your bag, grab the Fresh Talbuk Meat, and chuck it at the Panthara of your choosing. You're going to want to make sure to throw the meat while you are feigned, and using camouflage is going to make this a bit easier. You're going to want to start taming as soon as it starts eating the food, because the buff from the food is very short and expires quickly. Next up is going to be two very unique and interesting models, Scar and Karkin, both located in the Molten Front. I'll go ahead and put a map up of the spawn locations on the screen for you to check out. Both very unique and metallic skins, and Karkin is actually going to be one of the only rare crab models in the game. Back in the day, we had to make sure to silence the Pyroclast Barrage before taming them. You do this by attacking, waiting for the Pyroclast Barrage, and interrupting him with a counter shot. At which point you would start your tame, and if you didn't get it in time, you would turtle out of there. But right now, at level 120, you can go ahead and just walk up in there and tame that guy, and have him in your stables today. Have them in your stables today, rather. Another one of my favorite models is going to be the Lightning Paw, present in Duskwood. I'll go ahead and put another map up on the screen. So just north of Stranglethorn Vale and south of the Elwynn Forest, you can see the little dots on the map, and that's where they're going to be spawning. So this guy is actually going to be hidden in some bushes as you're wandering around, and you're not going to be actually able to see him. What you will see, though, as you're looking around, if you're looking into these dark bushes, is a creepy little pair of yellow eyes, and that's how you know you found him. To make this find a little bit easier, use the macro /tar lightning paw, and that's going to automatically target him and let you know where he's at. Once you find him, go ahead and just throw up a flare, and he will pop up, and he will be tameable. Now, the catch here is that this guy is on a spawn timer anywhere between 2 and 12 hours, so good luck on your hunt. Lok Nahak. Otherwise known as the first ever spirit beast. Located in the Sholasar Basin, I'll put it up on the map once again. Nothing special about this guy other than that he's going to have many spawn locations. So just go ahead and make your rounds and once again use a macro /tar lok to target him. If he's nearby, the macro should target him, letting you know where he's at. Make sure to have your Track Beast ability on when you're looking for him. He is a neutral mob, so he's going to appear as a yellow dot on your map. Next up, another spirit wolf, Gara. Now, this guy's located in Shadow Moon Valley. Here's another map for you, and you can see he's going to spawn right in the upper right region. Taming Gara here is going to require another long quest line, and you must be in the Beast Mastery Specialization to start the quest. So what you're going to do is go to the burial fields in Shadow Moon Valley. Down at the southern end of the field, there's going to be a grave site, and it's going to have a spirit wolf there named, you guessed it, Gara. You can go up and talk to her, and she's going to ask you to scratch her ears. And this is going to start your quest chain. You're going to have to go pick some shadow berries. Now, once you get all those berries for her, she's going to ask you to put together a spirit effigy, which is basically going to involve running around all of Draenor, killing different types of mobs. So I'll put a screenshot up on the screen of all the different materials and the areas that you need to go to kill mobs in order to get these items. Other than that, the quest line is pretty straightforward, so just continue on until you end up in the Void Realm and you kill Zaun. Once you kill him, Garrow will become tameable, and there you have it. Next up, we have Benthalos. Located in Mount Hyjal, I have another map for you guys. He's going to be spawning on the left side there. And this, I believe, is the only spirit beast that is a bird. Or maybe not. Maybe the only owl, though. Either way, this guy's going to be a tricky tame because you can't just walk up to him and tame him. He flies actually so high above the ground that you're not able to. What you have to do is aggro him while you're flying and survive the fall from extreme heights. What you're going to want to do first is make sure you have completed the quest chain for Mount Hyjal, and then you're going to want to wait, because the spawn timer is between 6 and 17 hours, so you might be pitching a tent for a little while. So what you're going to do is you're going to fly up, and you're immediately going to start falling. Attack in the air to aggro, and as you're falling, you can either use slow fall, if you're using a feather main pet, or you can just fall to the ground and disengage right before you land to prevent you from dying. When he makes his way down to the ground with you, you are free to tame him. Now just make sure you're going to be over level 90, otherwise you might have to turtle, you might have to take a little bit more damage than you're expecting. Next up is our good friend Skull. Really cool blue lightning wolf, unique from any other model in the game. Now this guy's going to be in the Storm Peaks, and he's going to be spawning right there in the middle at those three locations. Skull is a spirit beast introduced in Wrath of the Lich King, and there's not really anything special to taming him other than that he's going to spawn in multiple locations. So once again, you're just going to make your rounds between these three points and use the macro /tar skull. Once he's targeted, you'll know he's near and you can go down and tame him up. Once again, make sure to turn on your track beast while looking for him. He is a neutral mob, so he's going to show up as a yellow dot on your map. Next up is going to be Death to Lack, a really cool, purpley, molten, fiery spider. Very unique from any other model in the game. This guy's going to be in the Molten Front. Spawn locations are going to be over on the right side there. So the only thing about this guy here is in order to tame him, you have to bring him below 20% health. It's okay, though, because he is scaled to level 120, so you're not going to accidentally kill him. The catch here is his ability Death Strike, which is basically a one-shot. He will instantly kill you. So basically what you want to do here is engage in combat, send your pet after him, make sure the pet takes Deathlack's aggro, and when you use Death Strike, your pet will die. And when Death Strike is activated, Death to Lack will lose 10% of his health. At this point, he's going to start coming after you, so make sure to put concussive shots and tar traps on him. And while he's slowed, revive your pet and rinse and repeat. Send the pet in, your pet's going to die, Death to Lack's health's going to get a little bit lower, and eventually, once you get below 20%, you'll be able to tame him. A little bit more of a finicky tame on this one, so good luck on your hunt, guys. Our next challenge tame is going to be the Iron Juggernaut. Now, this is a boss in the Siege of Orgrimmar raid, and he is a mechanical, so you're going to need the Mechabond Imprint Matrix before you're able to tame him. Now, the boss itself is not tameable, so what you're going to want to do is go into the Siege of Orgrimmar raid, kill the Iron Juggernaut boss. Killing him is going to give you a pile of Juggernaut parts. You're going to want to continue on and kill Siege Crafter Blackfuse, and he's going to give you an item called Blackfuse's Power Core. And now, as you walk around Siege of Orgrimmar, there's going to be different paint buckets that you can pick up. And the paint bucket that you pick up, or the paint bucket that you decide to use, is going to determine the color of your Iron Juggernaut. So once you have the pile of Juggernaut parts, Blackfuse's Power Core, and a bucket of paint, assemble all of your parts, and it will create a deactivated Juggernaut of your color choice. Clicking on the deactivated Juggernaut will summon the Juggernaut as a neutral mob, and you'll be able to tame it. Now, it's important to note that you can only tame the Juggernaut inside the Siege of Orgrimmar raid. So follow these simple steps and you're going to have yourself a pretty badass metal scorpion. Next up is Fenrir, another very popular pet among veteran hunters. He's going to be located in the Halls of Valor. I'll put up a map on the screen. You can see he spawns on the left side of the island there. Now Fenrir is a boss in the Halls of Valor dungeon. Now, the trick to this guy is you can only tame him if you enter the dungeon solo. Now, during Legion, this was very challenging, but now the battle for Azeroth's out and we outrank this dungeon by 10 levels, it's not going to be too hard. So what you're going to want to do is just go in, kill trash mobs if you please until you get to Fenrir. I believe the first time you encounter him, he's going to run away and you just got to follow him to the second cave. And you're actually going to want to kill him. And once you kill him, a tameable, non-hostile version of him will spawn in the cave that you kill him in. Dismiss your current pet and tame away. Portent. Another really unique model. I'm not too much of a fan of it. Belongs to the Quilin family, and it's going to be present in the Vale of Eternal Blossoms. I got a map here for you. As you can see, there's multiple spawn locations all over the map. And let me tell you, this guy is a pain in the ass. Okay, so first of all, what you're going to want to do is open up your settings, click on System, go to Graphics, and turn your ground clutter all the way down. I'm going to explain to you why. Because the port in here is actually invisible. So what you're going to want to do is fly around to all these spawn locations on the map that I have just previously shown you. And look around for a little dusty track, just like this one here up on the screen. When you see a dusty track, pay attention to the way the footprint is facing and follow that direction until you find another one. When you find that other one, pay attention to which way the footprint is facing and continue on until you find an area where there are no footprints. Now, if you can't see a footprint, stay right where you are and keep your eyes peeled for more footprints to pop up. If you see another track pop up in front of you, immediately cast a flare. And it's going to reveal the pet in front of you. Once he's visible, you can either attack him or just immediately start your tame, and there you have it. Now, as a side note, I think this is one of my favorite mechanics in the game as a hunter, because, like I said, it's truly endgame. This requires effort, determination, coordination, and patience. Now, in the future, I'm going to be doing a video on all the other pets that you have to actually track. And if that's something you're interested in, go ahead and let me know down in the comment section. If not, just go ahead and subscribe to the channel, and that video will be up shortly. Next up is going to be the Fellbound Wolf. Really, really cool, bright green, fiery wolf. Gonna be in the Tannin Jungle. I got a map up on the screen here for you of his possible spawn locations. What you gotta do to tame this guy is head over to the south of Tannin Jungle. You gotta kill a enemy named Fel Rangari Anara. Looting him will give you a vial of Fel Cleansing, and then from there what you gotta do is go find the Fellbound Wolf. Use the vial of Fel Cleansing on him, and that will make the pet tameable. And that's going to be it for our challenging tames, guys. So if you're looking for a good piece of endgame content as a hunter and you are just burnt out on all your standard PvP and PvE activities, this is going to be a nice good time sink and something that is very interesting and belongs only to the hunter class. All right, next up, we're going to be going over just some unique and interesting models. Nothing too special about these guys other than their appearance. These are one-of-a-kind pets, and having them is going to be another little flex into your pet stables. First up is Thok the Bloodthirsty. I actually use this guy on a daily basis. He's going to belong to the Ferocity pet family. This is another boss in the Siege of Orgrimmar raid, a lot less complicated than the Metal Scorpions we were going over earlier. With this guy, you can just walk up to him, dismiss your pet, and tame him. Another one of my favorite unique models is Bullwinkle. Now he's over in Stormheim. I'll go ahead and give you a location of where he spawns. This guy actually is a spirit beast, and once again, I believe the only moose model that is an actual spirit beast. The only trick to taming this guy is to climb to the top of the mountain on the map that I have showed you. But if you have flying, it shouldn't be a problem. You'll be able to see him grazing among a bunch of other, goats. But once you see him, you can go ahead and just walk up to him and tame him. Now here's this freaking travesty of a creature, the Chimeron. Is that one head in the front, one head on the side, two arms on two sides, and a mini arm on the other. I mean, what is this thing? Pretty cool looking, though, I guess. The Chimeron is going to belong to the Hydra family, and as such can only be tamed by Beast Mastery hunters. So go ahead and equip your BM specialization and go into Blackwing Descent raid. He's another tameable boss, and much like Death to Lack, you're going to have to bring his health below 20%. So if you're anywhere above level 100, you're going to want to experiment with taking off a couple pieces of gear to make sure that you don't do too much damage and kill him right off the bat, because Blackwing Descent was a relayed release back in Cataclysm. Next, we have the Plague Toad. I see a lot of hunters using this guy, a really cool and unique model. Going to be located in the Temple of Sethrilis. Now, there's a couple other frog models in the game, but no other model like this giant toad here. So basically, you're going to want to go into Temple of Sethrilis, normal, heroic, or mythic. And these guys will spawn during the final boss encounter. So just dismiss your pet during the final boss encounter and make sure to tame one of these little plague toads here. My number three favorite on this list is Somber Dawn. Somber Dawn belongs to the Stag family, and he's just this really cool obsidian with some fiery hooves and a fiery horn, and just no other color schemes in the game like this. Nothing special to taming him, he is just one of a kind and one of the cooler stag models in the game. Now, if you're an Alliance player, you're going to be able to pick up this faction-specific pet. Located in Stormwind City, the Lost Spectral Griffin. I'll put a map up on the screen for where he spawns. So if you head over to the Griffin Mount Cellar, you're going to see a bright blue and white feather with a slight glow around it. If you click that feather, it will spawn the Lost Spectral Griffin as a neutral NPC right there, ripe and ready for you to tame. Do note that this is a spirit beast, so you're going to need to be in the Beast Mastery spec in order to tame him. Now on the Horde side, another spirit beast is Gone. Really cool blue-looking spectral raptor, going to be located in Orgrimmar. Now, it's a similar mechanic for this guy. You're just going to walk over to the Warlock Trainer's Hut, and there's going to be a blue glowing egg next to a pile of skulls. Destroying that egg is going to spawn Gone as a neutral NPC, and you will be able to tame him right then and there. And like I said, he is a spirit beast, so make sure you have the Beast Mastery specialization equipped. Now, one of the most sought-after hunter pets in the game currently is the Terrapin, the only turtle model with this really cool glowing lava fiery shell. Very unique and definitely one of a kind. He's going to be walking around Mount Hyjal in this lower lava-coated region here. Now, the only challenge to taming this guy is you have to have a lot of patience because his respawn timer can range anywhere from 6 to 12 hours. So this might be one of those pets where if you're flying over the area, you might want to just pop down and see if he's roaming. If not, if you got the patience for it, good luck to you, my friend. Next, we have the Lowland Mana Shell, another turtle model. Really, really cool with these little runic imprints on his shell there. Located in Suramar in the northwestern corner here. Now, he's not going to spawn unless you walk around and kill a regular lowland hard shell. Now, it's not a 100% chance, so you're just going to want to run around this area and kill all the lowland hard shells you can find, and eventually, a lowland mana shell will spawn. Doesn't take too long, but you're going to have to do a little bit of ad clearing, and once he pops up, he is ready and able to tame. Next up, we have a couple astral porcupines. Now we have four color variations here. We have a red, a green, and a blue, and they're all going to spawn on the lower part of the Valley of the Four Winds. I got a map up on the screen for you. In order to tame one of these guys, you're going to have to bring their health below 30%, so once again, you might have to take off a little bit of gear to ensure that you don't insta-kill him. And what's nice about this guy is that he's only on a 10 to 15 minute respawn timer, so just walk around the area, do some exploring, and if you want a really cool and unique spirit beast spectral porcupine, this is where you're going to find him. Arcturus is another spirit beast. It's going to be a bear model. Located in the Grizzly Hills right along this riverbank here, the only trick to this guy is that he's got a spawn timer around 12 hours. So if you don't mind waiting, more power to you. But again, you might want to just stop by here daily or if you're in the area and see if he's up. And last but not least, our final pet for the day is Ghostcrawler. Once again, another spirit beast. Make sure to be in the Beast Mastery specialization before you try to tame him. Going to be located in the Abyssal Depths. Right there on the lower left portion of the map. This guy's going to be pretty simple to tame, although sometimes he will randomly disappear while patrolling. So just make sure to use your Track Beast ability, and if you need to, use the macro /tar ghostcrawler in order to be able to locate him. Once you see him, get over there and tame him quickly, because like I said, he might just disappear out of nowhere.